want you to go in your Bibles to 2 Timothy chapter 1, and I will pray while you're turning there. Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you that your word is always relevant to our lives. It's always relevant. We don't have to make it relevant. It is always relevant. You always tell us what we need to hear when we need to hear it. You said we have an anointing from you and we know all things. We know exactly what we need to know when we need to know it. We thank you, Father, that you're helping us to guide us through all truth and to see perspective today. You have a much different vantage than we do without you, but we're not without you, and so we can have your vantage as to the things that are happening in the world today. And so we thank you, Father, for clarity. I thank you for unction, that you will speak through me. I yield myself right now to you. I call the gift of teaching into operation. And Lord, you will speak through me now in Jesus' name. Amen. I approach this with much fear and trembling. Fear as in awe, not like you're afraid of a rattlesnake, but the respect and awe that we have. 2 Timothy chapter 1, look at verse 7. You guys all know it. For God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. I don't know if that's highlighted in your Bible, but it should be. Anytime that fear tries to come on you, you know immediately, this is not from God. I have power, I have love, and I have a sound mind. And so we remind ourselves of those things. Today, the title is, We're Ready for This. We're ready for this. Amen. You know, so many times there's a tragedy or a catastrophe that happens, and people scurry to get ready. No, we've been getting ready. And I will say this to preface what we're going to talk about today. It is not a time to be passive. Not a time to be casual and passive about our walk with God. Because if we do that, we can be caught off guard. None of what happened last Saturday caught God off guard. Now, let me also say, none of it was his plan. You'll hear that kind of stuff. He came to give us life and to give it to us more abundantly. The thief comes to steal, to kill, and to destroy, right? So it doesn't have the fingerprints of God. It has the fingerprints of the devil, our enemy. Amen? Now, I want you to go over to 2 Timothy chapter 4. Now, when we look at end time events, and you'll notice I don't teach on that a whole lot. There's guys that I feel have an anointing for that, guys like Hilton Sutton, although he's gone on to be with the Lord. I got to meet him and am friends with his widow. But there's guys like that can break that stuff down and do it well. And when they do, like Hilton, in Hilton's case, when they break it down, you don't have fear. You have peace. It ministers peace when it's rightly divided. But I will say this, that the accuracy of biblical prophecies are not clear until you're on the other side of it. Amen. You know, and there's guys, they'll Matthew 24 specifically, go in there and start looking at it and say, well, this is going to happen, this is going to happen. You don't know. There's some things that are obvious. And we're going to look at the 50,000-foot view. I'm not going to try to get into the minutiae of the details because I don't think that's fruitful. What we need to look at are a couple of things. Number one, the big picture things. This is not the end. This is the beginning of the end. The exact phrase in Matthew 24:8 is the beginning of sorrows. And I believe that also started with COVID when we talked about pestilence, right? We talk about that. That happened. That's when we kind of took a look at that. And so another thing to remember, Israel is center stage in God's end time calendar. And people say, where's the U.S.? Depends on how close you're standing to Israel. Because Israel's it. Are you with me? Okay? And then the other thing is not good news. It's going to get worse. It's going to get worse. As horrible as the things that we were made aware of. You know, I found out last week, right as we were doing praise and worship practice, Pastor Josh asked me, did you hear about Israel? And I'm like, no, I don't watch the news. I just don't. I've watched the news more this week than I have in the last 3 years. Some of it I wished I hadn't watched. Now, I don't just turn on the big news networks. I don't do that. I don't turn on CNN and Fox News or MSNBC. I don't do that. If you do, God bless you. But, man, you're going to have to pray, right? CNN stands for constant negative news. I mean, you just can't, you know, you can't do it. I can't. So I'm real picky about who I choose. So I chose CBN News. That's 700 Club. I want something that comes through the biblical worldview. I want something that's about Christianity and will bring perspective. And even in that, I heard some stories in an interview I wish I hadn't heard. I'm not going to share those. It's horrific, and it's like I sat on the couch just weeping. And anyway, so there's a lot of horror going on right now, but to try to get into the biblical prophecies now, I'm talking about biblical prophecies. There's a lot of prophecy outside the Bible, and a lot of those guys had egg on their face after the last presidential election. You know what I mean? That's subjective. Biblical prophecy is not subjective, although our interpretation is. Okay? And only in hindsight can you see it clearly. Okay? So when something happens, you'll say, oh, that's what he meant. Oh, I see now. And I'll give you a really, really good example. We got this in Bible college. Micah, let's say concerning Jesus. Pull up the next one, Harrison. When you look at Micah, it talks about Jesus being from Bethlehem. Then you look at Matthew 2:23, it says he'll be from Nazareth. Then you look at Hosea 11:1, he's coming out of Egypt. Now, in foresight, you're looking at it like that is a contradiction, times three, right? That you can't understand it. But now you know the events. He's born in Bethlehem. He lived in Nazareth, and they fled to Egypt for a season. Do you see it? And it all makes perfect sense. That's the only way you can accurately see those prophetic things. Amen? Now, there are some players in Matthew's writings, in the book of Revelation, that are clearly there. And I don't want to try to go in and get into any of that, because I don't think that's fruitful. What I want to know is, how do we respond? What do we do, right? That, to me, is what's important. And I'm going to remind you of a few things. Our part is to stay ready with his word. Stay ready with his word. We lived in Clarksville for 10-plus years, and so we knew a lot of soldiers. And John can testify to this. There's no such thing as, we're ready. No, you are in the process of getting ready until they need you. Even if everything's done, everything's ready, you still are preparing. You're getting ready. And that's what the Lord prompted my heart. And then you see in 2 Timothy 4, look at verse 2, the A part of that. Preach the word, be ready in and out of season. I typically look at that as like, okay, I'm going to run into somebody today and they're going to need the word. They want to know about the gospel. Well, there's not time to go do a word study, so I better have it, right? You keep yourself in a state of readiness. That means you're always staying prepared, preparing, staying prepared, preparing, staying prepared. In fact, the New Living Translation says, be prepared whether the time is favorable or not. We may face some unfavorable times. Interesting that last week's message, which was sort of an interruption, was redeeming the time. Redeeming the time. We could have gone right down that road. That could have easily been our main text scripture. Amen? Now, you go over to Proverbs chapter 21. This will be a very somber thing. Like I said, some of the things I heard were horrific. And I'll tell you, there's a pattern that we see whenever Israel gets some sort of attack like this, although this is probably their worst since they became a nation. Invariably, within a short amount of time, all this misinformation gets out there, and the idea that, well, they're making it up, this really didn't happen. And, you know, so what that does, this journalist that I was hearing the interview with said that forces us to have to reveal footage, which we would rather not do. You don't want those images. You're not made for those images. I remember when Daniel Pearl was beheaded, our drummer up in Clarksville, watched the video. I'm like, no, there's no way you're going to make me do that. I had a friend who was in Special Forces. His job was to debrief computers, bad guys' computers, terrorist computers. And the things that this guy had to take in his eye gate messed him up really bad. Now, he could stop and function and stay on task, but he put a vault over his heart. And one day, somebody put a thumbnail of a beheading on Facebook, and it sent him high and to the right. It opened that door, and I saw terror. And this is all meant to instill fear. Who remembers when the first time you went shopping when COVID, when lockdown was happening, and you saw people dragging two grocery carts in a full panic? The fear was tangible. Well, this is way more than that. Way more than that. Oh, wow. Did you find Proverbs yet? The point is to be in a state of readiness with his word. Proverbs 21, look at verse 31. The horse is prepared for the day of battle, but deliverance is of the Lord. So we don't fear, we pray. We have our part. We get the horse ready, but deliverance is ultimately going to come from God. Amen? Remember to stay out of fear. So we will do our part and trust God to do his part. We will do our part and trust God to do his part, and he will. In fact, the next reminder is that God is faithful to his covenant. Go over to Deuteronomy 7. He is faithful to his covenant. Man, I had so much in my heart I wanted to say. You know, Jesus was giving a parable, the 10 minas, I think is how it's pronounced. Couldn't get anybody to agree on how it's pronounced. But the master says, occupy until I come. In our pastor's meeting, we were talking about, what do we do? What do we do? Out of my mouth came, occupy till he comes. Keep doing what you know to do. Are you with me? Amen. Deuteronomy 7, look at verse 9. He is the faithful God who will keep his covenant for 1,000 generations and lavish his unfailing love. How long is 1,000 generations? We haven't seen that yet. Amen? Psalm 89. Go over there. Psalm 89. I want you to see these things because you can rest in God when you really trust him. Now, if we're kind of passive and we're like, I don't know if I want to go to church today or what. And I'm not talking about church attendance. I'm not that guy. Sometimes people come up and apologize. I'm sorry I wasn't there. I'm like, I'm not that guy. Please don't. You know, God will take what he gets. But you know what? This is the day to be active in this what's happening, and not passive. Psalm 89, look at verse 34. My covenant I will not break, nor alter the word that has gone out of my lips. He is a covenant-keeping God. He is faithful to his covenant. If he said it, it's not a possibility that he will go back on his word. In fact, go over to Hebrews chapter 6. The next reminder I want to give you is remember our hope. Remember our hope. Do not fear. Do not fear. Not from God. Do not fear. It's okay to be concerned, but we don't worry. And there's a difference. We care, but we don't carry the care. Does that make sense? There's a balance there. And the enemy is very shrewd, very tricky, very effective at getting people into fear and calling it, sometimes people are in worry and they're up all night praying. That's not a good thing. Thank you, Steve. All right. It's true. Think about it. If I'm in fear and I get up all night and I'm praying, now, if I'm just trying to fellowship with the Lord to replace that fear, great. Nothing wrong with that. But if I'm praying a circumstance and I'm praying from the place of fear, I am taking the Lord's name in vain. I'll leave that alone. Fear has no place in any of this, what we're talking about. Look at verse 18 of Hebrews 6. So God has both given his promise and his oath. When you back up a little bit, you find out that he could swear by no one greater. So he swore by himself. See, when this is covenant talk. When you enter into a covenant, you swear by somebody greater than you. And there's an exchange, an agreement. That's what this is talking about. This is covenant talk. So God has both given both his promise and his oath. These two things are unchangeable. One translation says immutable. Because it is impossible for God to lie. Therefore, we who have fled to him for refuge can have great confidence as we hold to the hope that lies before us. You go to him for refuge. I said you go to him. We hide in the rock. Are you with me? Verse 19, here it is. This hope is a strong and trustworthy anchor for our souls. Now that's the human part of us, right? Hope is the anchor of our soul. What does an anchor do? You drop it down and it keeps the ship from leaving the area where it's at. Hope keeps you anchored to God. And that's what we do. We stay in that hope. Amen? Remember that hope. It leads us through the curtain into God's inner sanctuary. Jesus has already gone in for us. He has become our eternal high priest in the order of Melchizedek. Say Melchizedek. Just fun to say. Melchizedek. No, we were going to talk about Melchizedek today. And it's ready. It's in the job queue, but we didn't get to it today. God redirected yesterday and put this thing together. Now, I want you to remember God's protection. Go to Psalm 91. So we're to occupy till he comes. It's definitely not time to freak out. That doesn't help. Or complain. It's time to pray. It's time to pray. And if anything, it's helping to anchor our soul to him. We're hiding in the rock. He's our refuge. We're hiding there. He keeps his covenant. Well, we're going to read about his covenant. He said he would protect us. Amen? Now, some of this that's going on in Israel, we know from the terrorists' own words that they want us in that same situation. Death to America, I think is how they said it. You know, I was in a conversation. I'm hesitant to say this because some of them might be watching. Where I hear people saying Israel had this coming. What? You know, that, when I heard that, that's offensive. And I had to really put my heels in the ground not to take offense. See, offenses will come, but it's up to me if I take the offense. It was offensive. And so the statement was made after 9/11, Israel did nothing to help the United States. And I thought, what rock were you under? You know, are you serious? And it just so happens, I have to find it, but I have a letter from Ariel Sharon, written September 12, 2001, to President George W. Bush. And it was a personal letter. I have a copy of it. I got it through Jim Caseman. And you can tell by the writing, it is very human. It is very personal. Some diplomat didn't write this. This was a person to person. And he said, when this happened to America, it happened to Israel. That's covenant talk. Whatever you have is mine. Whatever is mine is yours. That's covenant talk. So anyway, I could get indignant. I could get very passionate very quickly. And some of the people I heard saying those things were equally passionate. But it's hard to reconcile that for me. I mean, innocent people just dragged out of their homes and slaughtered. The images, even though they were blurred out, you could tell. I'm glad I couldn't see the details. You know, we need to pray for those responders. They're still, as of Wednesday, they were still looking for bad guys, still fighting, trying to secure an area, and they're having to walk over massacred people, families, toys in the yard with blood all over it. I mean, yeah, they deserve that, right? That's offensive. Amen. But it is a sign of the times. It's the beginning of the end. It's the beginning of the end. How long is that going to be? We occupy like it's 100 years. Are you with me? I personally believe, and there's a lot of debate about this. I wasn't going to go down this road, but I guess we are. My personal belief is that we will be raptured before the worst of that. And I think that's the purpose of the rapture. And in fact, once the church, who restrains, it's the righteousness that restrains a lot of the evil, when the church is taken out of the way, oh, there's nothing to hold that stuff back. Are you with me? Now, there's, you know, great debate about pre-trib, post-trib, you know, all that stuff, mid-trib. What I read in Matthew is, be counted worthy that you may be counted worthy to escape all these things. That, to me, sounds like the rapture. Yes. Sign me up. I'm on board. I'm going in the first load. First load, I'm in. Take me out. Anybody with me? Now, you know, I don't want to get into that big debate. It's a can of worms. It's a big can of worms. But, you know, we need to know what God thinks about it. Some people say, I don't know what I think about it. Well, let's find out what God thinks about it. Amen. Psalm 91. Let's start reading in verse 1. I'm going to read the whole psalm, and I hope that's okay. He who dwells in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. We're under His shadow. That's a good place to be. Amen. I will say of the Lord, He is my refuge and my fortress, my God, in Him I will trust. We had a tornado come through one time, it was in Marion County. And we lived in Dunellen at the time, and it was, what, probably 11 at night or something like that. All the power went out, and you could hear the proverbial train. And we had the tornado warning, and we're like, uh-oh, this isn't good. And so we're there with a flashlight under the covers. He who dwells in the secret place of the Most High. I mean, we are reading that psalm, and, you know, I won't say I wasn't afraid, but we were concerned, that's for sure. Surely he shall deliver you from the snare of the fowler and from the perilous pestilence. Okay, there's that COVID, right? And that may not be the worst thing that gets unleashed. Amen? He shall cover you with his feathers, and under his wings you shall take refuge. His truth, here, there's the word part of it. His truth shall be your shield and buckler. Everything before that is talking about a dwelling place, a place of refuge, under his wing, like chicks under a mama's wing, okay? Now we're talking about a defensive weapon, your shield and your buckler. The shield is to keep you from taking artillery directly. The buckler is for hand-to-hand combat. It's a small mini shield, right? Let's see, verse 5. You shall not be afraid of the terror by night. He doesn't want us afraid, nor of the arrow that flies by day. Think about what the scenery looked like over there as they're lobbing those rockets. It looked like an old gladiator movie where they're shooting their fiery arrows, right? Dozens of them at a time. Nor of the pestilence that walks in darkness, nor of the destruction that lays waste at noonday. 1,000 may fall at your side and 10,000 at your right hand, but it shall not come near you. That means it's happening in proximity. Amen? You know, for us, everything changed September 11th, 2001. That's when this whole terrorist war, and see, they don't defend a border. Their border is their ideology. It's a way of thinking. And I can tell you, I had a conversation with somebody this week. We shouldn't expect the devil to play nice, like he has some sort of Geneva Convention that he adheres to. He is as sick and as depraved and as wicked. There is no boundary to the wickedness at all. And so we can't expect that. Are you with me? And it may happen around you, but the promise here is that it's not going to touch you. Okay? Verse 8, only with your eyes shall you look and see the reward of the wicked. The reward of the wicked is coming. It's coming. Because you have made the Lord, who is my refuge, even the Most High your dwelling place, no evil shall befall you, nor shall any plague come near your dwelling. That's a great promise. Can you say amen? You ought to read that. If anything, I would start my day with that right there. No evil shall befall you, nor shall any plague come near your dwelling. For, because he gives his angels charge over you to keep you or guard you in all your ways. In their hands they shall bear you up, lest you dash your foot against a stone. The enemy tried to use that very passage to tempt Jesus, right? But it's still a promise. Angels are involved in your life. It's true. There's angels. Give them something to do. Get your words out there. They hearken diligently to the sound of God's word. Give God's word sound. So they got something to do. You got protection. You know, we talk about healthcare. We've got out of this world protection. Amen. Oh, I thank you, Jesus. Verse 13, you shall tread upon the lion and the cobra, the young lion and the serpent you shall trample underfoot. Now notice in verse 14, the narrator changes. Up until this, we're talking to God, about God. Now God is talking, okay? Because he has set his love upon me, therefore I will deliver him. I will set him on high because he has known my name. He shall call upon me and I will answer him. I will be with him in trouble and will deliver him and honor him. You hear all those I will, I will, I will, I will. It's impossible for God to lie. And that's the anchor. That's our hope. I'm anchored to the fact God can't lie. This is what he said. This is what I can expect. Do you believe it? Now, you can live like it's not true. Again, we can go back to that passivity thing. You know, somebody says, well, okay, sarah, sarah, whatever. Man, don't put yourself out there like that. There's protection available. Amen? You're here today, so this is good. All right. I'm going to read verse 15 again because it's just so good. He shall call upon me and I will answer him. I will be with him in trouble. I will deliver him and honor him. With long life, I will satisfy him and show him my salvation. Salvation is another word for protection. It's a package word, just like the word shalom. This is another package word, salvation. In the Greek New Testament is the word soteria, and it's much like the word sozo. When we say they got saved, well, that means protection, health, prosperity, preservation. You know, the Lord preserves us, and it's all of that definition whenever you use it. Not just one aspect of it, it's all of it. Amen? So he said he would deliver us. Now, I'm not going to belabor this very long, but I just want to remind you what we learned today, okay? I felt like we needed to disarm what's happening because people could be afraid. And it's not time to be in fear. It's time to press into God and be ready. Be ready. Be ready. Hopefully nothing happens over here. That would be wonderful. But the chances of that are probably small. Okay? And I don't want you in fear, but we want to be, what's the word that everybody uses, vigilant? Let's do that in our faith. How are we going to survive this? By faith. We're going to live by faith. It's all by faith. We don't change that. We don't, the enemy's trying this. Well, let me try something else. You got the A plan going already. Stay with it. Amen? Stay in the course. In fact, number one that we learned, stay prepared with his word. Number two, God is faithful to his covenant. These are the things to remember. Remember our anchor of hope. Hope is the Greek word confident expectation based on solid certainty. We confidently expect God to keep his covenant. We confidently expect God to do all the I wills that he said, right? We confidently expect that. That's faith. When you're confident, that's faith. You believe a thing. You're persuaded. Amen? And then lastly, God's protection. God's protection. This day and age, I tell you what, we need it. We need God's protection. And he's doing it. I'm sure when I get to the next experience, they're going to play some videos for me and show me all the protection that I enjoyed without even knowing it. Things happen where God is thwarting things that would have happened in my life to protect me and watch over me, especially when I was before Christ, when I was playing in the devil's yard and having a good time. Are you with me? Anybody else attest? And God still was merciful and watched over me and protected me. Amen? Praise God. Well, did you get anything out of that? Do you have hope now? Or are you going to reject fear? Yes.
I'm not supposed to talk, but it's fine. I just want to tell you, I also heard, man, it's like when bad stuff happens, everybody becomes an expert. Anybody else a foreign policy expert? Me too. But I just want to say this. I heard that this is the thing I've heard the most, is that this has nothing to do with America. I'll challenge them with scripture. In Ezekiel 38, which I recommend you read, because it's not a scary chapter, it's a winning chapter. And it's talking about what we're living right now. We're in it today, right here, right now. And as this big group of nations, primarily Russia and Iran, are attacking Israel, there's this little group of people, Sheba and Dedan, that is Saudi Arabia. And there's also these weirdos, the merchants of Tarshish and their young lions. Now, who's that? Anybody know? You go look at a map when this was written. Tarshish is England. And the merchants and the young lions, that's Bible language for offspring. Well, guess who America is? We're an offspring of the big lion. Anybody know the symbol of England? It's a lion. We're the young lion. And guess what Sheba, Dedan, Tarshish, and their merchants and young lions say to these attacking nations? What do you think you're doing? It says that. You can see it in a lot of translations, but I'll just read. This is what we say to these armies. Do you really think the armies you've gathered can rob them of silver and gold? Do you think you can drive away their livestock and seize their goods and carry off a plunder? We have a part to play. I said we have a part to play as Christians, but also as Americans. We're in that book right there. And there's no really, you know, I know a lot of this. I agree with Pastor Wade. Interpreting prophecy on this side is kind of a black hole. It's really hard. But I'll die on that hill because the maps say what they say. Amen. You got to undo geography for this not to work. And so I agree. We need to pray. We need to pray for wisdom for our leaders, that they would follow in the footsteps that have been prophesied, that these things are going to happen, and that we are going to be a part of what's happening in the Middle East. Now, I don't want war. I don't like that idea, but I like being a part of God's prophecies. Amen.
Amen. So what we'll do, before we take communion, let's pray. And we talked about praying, let's actually pray. And so I want you to add your faith. If two of you agree on earth concerning anything they ask, it shall be done for them by my Father in heaven. And so we're going to agree together. One puts 1,000 to flight and two put 10,000. There's an exponential, or we learned last week, fold in the power. Are you hearing that? It doubles the power every time you add one. So we got quite a bit in this room alone. So add your faith. Just say, I agree, as we're praying. So, Father, we lift up the nation of Israel. And, Lord, we hurt with them. We feel what they've been through. We feel that. We are touched by the trauma. And, Lord, we are moved with compassion to do something. And we pray. It's not the least we can do. It's something we should do. And we pray right now. You said that we are to pray your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. So we pray your will into that situation, into that area. We ask for wisdom for the leaders, all those that are making decisions about how to execute a campaign, how to implement the strategy. Give them divine knowing, knowledge, words of knowledge. What we see in 1 Corinthians 12, whether they realize it's the gifts of the Spirit or not, doesn't matter. We need them to have divine intelligence. And we thank you for it, Father. In Jesus' name, we ask. You said, if anyone lacks wisdom, let him ask you who gives to all liberally and without reproach. We also ask for wisdom as to how to help those who have been traumatized, those families that have suffered those images and those losses and that horror that has been perpetrated on innocent people. Lord, you described murder as the shedding of innocent blood. This is murder. This is murder. And we thank you, Father. We know that you hate murder. You hate it. You hate it. And so, Father, we thank you for divine strategies. And I also pray for unity between our nation and Israel. Unity, strong brotherhood and bond between our nations in Jesus' name. And we thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. We thank you. Thank him right now. Just say, I agree, and I thank you, Lord. Thank you, Father, that you can walk us through this. We pray for comfort from the Comforter in Jesus' name. Comfort now over those families, over those who have no idea where their loved ones are. We pray for the safe return of every hostage in Jesus' name. Every single hostage. We ask for it all, Lord. That is your will. Your will be done on the earth. And Lord, you show us, show those who are in charge how to do it. And we call on angels to be involved. We see in the Bible a phrase, the terror of the Lord. I pray that the terror of the Lord would be in manifestation over those trying to perpetrate terror onto the nation of Israel. They would run and set ambushes on themselves. Confusion in the camp of the enemy. In Jesus' name. And we rest and we trust you, Lord, that you're going to watch over us and guard us. Use us. We commit that at this moment in time, we will not be passive. We will not be passive. We will be active in your plan in this season. We will pray. We will pray. And we will not give ourselves to a spirit of grief. We will not allow that. We grieve, but only as God grieves. In Jesus' name, amen.